I have a wonderful chairperson, Dr. S.N. Gupta, to introduce our honorable speaker and my duty to introduce our honorable chairperson. Dr. S.N. Gupta is an MBBS alumnus of UCMS and MD Internal Medicine from SMS. He is a senior physician internal medicine at National Heart Institute. He is my friend and at one time was my student. Please welcome Dr. S.N. Gupta.
Thank you, sir. The topic of discussion for today, as already elucidated, has been pacemakers and the new generation of pacemakers. And a lot of development has gone into these new modalities of actually life-saving things which are now available for the average patient. We talk about CRT, CRTDs and continuous pacemakers also. So to have the ideal combination of the base of the jet for which patient to be used, that is something which is very essential, because these are expensive devices. And also not to forget the older generation pacemakers also, which are still in vogue for certain types of for majority of patients, let me say. So nobody better than Dr. Viveka, who's known to all of us, who's the Director Cardiac Cath Lab at Max and is an electrophysiologist also, and to talk about these pacemakers and the patient indications, may I hand over the mic to Dr. Vivek.
Well, so good evening, friends. And, first of all, thank St. Jude Medical, which is now Abbott. India. They were taken over by Abbott, and this topic is which pace up of which patient. So it means that, you know, there is a lot of confusion that, you know, even ICD is called a pacemaker, CRTD is also called a pacemaker. Pacemaker is a wide term, and in this forum itself we had discussed a lot of times, but I have simplified, and it's more of a case-based discussion about that, you know. So basically everyone has a pacemaker. We have a, you know, single chamber pacemaker. This is a VTP pacemaker where there is only one leaflet which senses the atrium also. This is a CRT where you can see the three wires, we call it biventricular pacemaker. And this lead, you can see it's more thicker than this CRTP lead. So this is a combo device which is called CRTD, which is an ICD lead also. And then you have a, you know, leadless pacemaker also, where the there is no lead. So leadless pacemaker is again an advancement. So basically, when we tell our patients that you need a pacemaker, he gets confused. And then the all of us who are not into hardcore cardiology and electrophysiology, they would also get confused that, you know, even a combo device is called a pacemaker. Single chamber pacemaker is also called a pacemaker. When you say that the combo device would cost something like 8 lakh rupees, they will say that my relative got a pacemaker in, you know, 1 lakh rupees. So we need to know that what are the differences between different kind of pacemakers. So pacemaker can come in a single chamber pacemaker, it can come a dual chamber pacemaker, it can be a, you know, CRT, which is called triple chamber pacemaker, it can be a CRTD, which is a defibrillator with a combination of a pacemaker, and it can be leadless pacemaker where there is no leads. And then it can be subcutaneous ICD, which is nothing goes inside the body and it is only outside, you know, on the pectoral side of the body. So this is a patient who has, you know, so if we look at the patient, this ECG, this is a practical example. So all of us know that the ventricular rate is 34 beats per minute, so heart rate is very low. And once somebody sees it on ECG, one can say that, you know, this is a patient who has got a very slow heart rate, would have prolotropic incompetence, the patient would feel very weak, and the patient would have, you know, persistent bradycardia, would have acquired AV blocks, permanent AF and AV block is there. And then it, these symptoms could be intermittent also, but meaning thereby that the bottom line is that this is the pacemaker patient who has got a very slow heart rate. So patient has got an ECG, left ventricular branch block with left axis deviation. So this is a patient where, you know, the patient would have symptoms of easy ventriculability. So if the patient has got symptomatic bradycardia, then he qualifies for a pacemaker. Asymptomatic ones would not qualify for a pacemaker. And typical symptoms of bradycardia would be easy practicability, irritability, testing, ability, capacity, forgetfulness, cognitive impairment, dizziness, and vertigo. And if it is happening intermittently, patient would have intermittent presyncope, syncope, and then light headedness and blurred vision. And because of that, there may be shortness of breath, heart failure, reduced exercise capacity, sudden dyspnea and strain unrelated to exercise, and even the palpitation also. Then, diagnosis of bradyarrhythmia is usually made from when a persistent, that is a standard ECG, but if it is happening once in a while, then we need to do ECG or Holter or what are called, you know, ELR, implantable loop recorder, or, you know, external loop recorder. So these are the things whereby we can find out, and then we could do sometimes the probability test like carotid sinus massage, gill table test, electrophysiology study, which is an invasive study, exercise test. We can look at the, you know, prototropic incompetence. This is a patient where the ejection fraction was normal, and you could see that the patient had syncopal attack, and then we were not able to find out why it is happening. In 24 hours of Holter monitoring showed significant sinus pauses, symptomatic bradycardia. This patient was refused to have a pacemaker, but you could see at the chin that he had some stitches also. She had repeated falls. And then, you know, when she came, we did a Holter, and that clearly showed that the patient had long sinus pauses and did that needed a pacemaker. So now the confusion comes. The patient would say that, you know, I have got a slow heart rate. Should I need a single chamber pacemaker or should I need a dual chamber pacemaker? So single chamber pacemaker and dual chamber pacemaker controversy is that the dual chamber pacemaker results in a small but potentially important benefit in patients with sinus node disease, AV nodal block. No difference in mortality has been observed. But the patient will have less breathlessness if the patient has got, you know, maintained AV syncope. So if the dual chamber pacemaker is given in patients who have got sinus pauses or the patients who has got what we call, you know, complete heart block, they will feel better off. Sinus node disease in patient with persistent sinus bradycardia, dual chamber pacing and the pacing mode is the first choice. Unnecessary RV pacing should be systematically avoided in patient with sinus bradycardia since it may cause atrial fibrillation and deterioration in heart failure. So lot of drop in ejection fraction is related to RV pacing. So all pacemakers like Saint and other companies also, they have come up with an algorithm where you have got maximum, you know, intrinsic rhythm and you minimize the right ventricular pacing. So we should avoid right ventricular pacing. And based on this tenet only, the left ventricular pacing has come up in a big way that, you know, you should give biventricular pacemaker so that ejection fraction improve. So that is why in countries like, you know, the International Heart Rhythm Society, even the European Society of Cardiology, European Heart Rhythm Society have given a recommendation that anyone whose ejection fraction is low, you should not do RV pacing, you should do a biventricular pacing so that the ejection fraction does not drop further. And then rate responsibility is important in younger patients because if he is walking, running, the heart rate based on the demand of the body should increase. And it improves the quality of life of the patient also. So, if we see the patient has intermittent or persistent sinus node disease, the chronotropic incompetence is there. If it is not there, then we can give the, you know, dual chamber pacemaker without rate responsiveness. But if the chronotropic incompetence is there, then we can give them a dual chamber rate responsive pacemaker. And even if the patient has got intermittent symptoms or intermittent, you know, sinus pauses, they are also, we can give them dual chamber pacemaker with rate responsiveness. But if the patient gets into AV block, where the symptoms are more because the unit is simply there. So if the patient has got the only condition where the patient would need a single chamber pacemaker is permanent atrial fibrillation. So we can give a simple VVIR pacemaker or a, you know, what we call leadless pacemaker, because as of now, the technology stands. It is a single chamber pacemaker. So if the patient has got, you know, complete heart block, then we give them dual chamber pacemaker. If the patient has got 2:1 block, we give them dual chamber pacemaker. But if the patient has got permanent atrial fibrillation, that's one indication. And in elderly population where the, you know, their activity level is lower, there also we can, you know, because we can use a what we call single chamber pacemaker or leadless pacemaker also. Then you know, this is a patient whom we discussed. Here we did a dual chamber pacemaker. Interestingly, you can see that these three spikes where I am putting my arrows, you can see that SARS spike followed by P wave. So this is an atrial pacing, and this patient did very well, and we encourage that this patient does not get ventricular pacing, because with the ventricular pacing, the ejection fraction might drop. So we encourage the intrinsic ventricular rhythm. We don't want most of the ventricular pacing, and the patient did well. This is a patient, you know, you would be knowing that the patient where we do TAVI, or those patients who even go for surgical aortic valve replacement, there also the patient may develop because of the, you know, surgery and stress on the aortic annulus and mitral annulus, which is bundle, may get compromised. The patient may get into, you know, heart blocks. So there also you might need a pacemaker. So this is a patient where, you know, we had syncopal attacks, we did a Holter, and then that showed long pauses on Holter. So this is a patient where, you know, the patient who has had one of our patients, you can see this is the X-ray of that patient. This patient had 20 years back a surgery for, you know, what we call atrial septal defect, and at that time the mitral regurgitation was less, but over 20 years of time, patient developed severe MR and severe TR, and then in this situation, the patient went for repeat MVR, MT, tricuspid repair, and in surgical ICU, the patient developed complete trap line in a few seconds and was symptomatic bradycardia. In this patient, we give her the, you know, this is a lady patient, so this is the mitral, you know, single chamber. Leadless pacemaker, so this is what we give to this patient. An advantage of leadless pacemaker, that the complication of leads and the pockets is taken off, so that problem is not there. So the patient who developed AV block, sinus node dysfunction, or the patient has got IDB AV block, complete heart block, where the dual chamber pacemakers are necessary. If the sinus holotropic competence is good, then we can do away with the dual chamber pacemaker. But if the sinus node is not good and the bronchotropic competence is not good, then that patient would need a rate responsive pacemaker. So this is again a case, real life case. This is a patient who has got ejection fraction of 25% and normal boundaries, had got easy petrol giddiness. And you can see the patient has got, you know, significant AV dissociation. You can see there are multiple, you know, P waves, and they are not married to the ORS complexes. So this is an AV dissociation. So this patient, because of his symptoms, was put on temporary pacemaker. And if you look at the guideline wise, this again shows that if the ejection fraction is low, and this is a guideline that shows that if the patient is on optimal medical treatment, ejection fraction is less than 30 or 35%, and if the patient has got significant symptoms, then this is the situation where we should give them the what we call triple chamber pacemaker, or CRTs. So CRTs will take care of these people, because as we know that only right ventricular pacing will increase the possibility of drop in ejection fraction. So if we look at the this patient where the ejection fraction is low, in this situation we should give them CRT rather than giving a standard dual chamber pacemaker. Then patient with cardiomyopathy on optimal medical therapy, and cardiomyopathy with low ejection fraction should not be declared if it is a new onset less than 3 months. We should always try to increase, you know. So we should, patient who has got history of low ejection fraction for less than 3 months, we should give them optimal medical therapy, and then see after 3 months what happens. If it is viral myocarditis or reversible causes of low ejection fraction, then we know that the ejection fraction will improve over time period. And after 3 months, even if the ejection fraction continues to be low, then we can, you know, give one of the patient therapies like CRT or CRT based on the patient's indication. So if we see that the special indication for CRTs are that it's triple chamber pacemaker, where one ventricular beat is in the right ventricle, one in the left ventricle. So these are the patients who are in triple pacing over a period of time, and then when the battery finishes or when the patient, the pacemaker reaches the end of battery life, then if the ejection fraction has dropped, then also we can upgrade those pacemakers to cardiac pacing fraction therapy in heart failure patients. So that is, clear cut guideline. So this is a patient where, you know, we have put the CRT and the patient is going fine. If the patient has got some complete heart block like this, then temporary pacing was put in and CRT rather than RV pacing is recommended, because this is a patient who has got AV dissociation. If we give the right ventricular pacing, which will be 100% right ventricular pacing, the ejection fraction is further drop. So in this situation where the ejection fraction is low, we should say that the patient would need a biventricular pacemaker, or conventionally we call it CRT pacing rather than the single chamber pacemaker. And all patients should need a CRT. So those who need a biventricular pacemaker should be given a CRT, unless the patients are very elderly and you don't want, you want to give them only quality of life, not quantity of life. Elderly patients where you don't want to extend the, you know, life, and so in those situations, for symptomatic benefit, you should give CRT alone. This is again a patient where you can see that the baseline escape rhythm is left ventral transmitter for the ejection fraction is 40%. And here also, you know, with the optimal medical therapy, you can see that, you know, CRT rather than RV pacing is recommended, because if the ejection fraction was more around normal, then we could have given the standard dual chamber pacemaker. But this is a situation where we should give a CRT pacing rather than normal. So this is a patient who underwent CRT, that is biventricular pacing, and is doing fine. So those patients who did not have any, those who have got normal coronaries, who did not have any ventricular tachycardia, in those situations we can avoid what we call CRTPs or pumpo devices and give them CRTP, that is pacing device alone. This is again a patient who has had, ejection fraction less than 35% and was class 3, class 4, who was undergoing replacement therapy. So when you are replacing the patient who was already on a pacemaker after 10 years, 15 years, then you must look at the ejection fraction. And if the ejection fraction is low, then you should give them upgradation to biventricular pacemaker or CRTs to improve their overall outcome. So this is a patient where the post pacemaker RV pacing dependent end of life, EOL is end of life, so that's a very scary situation, because the pacemaker has lost all the battery, and if you put a magnet and all, then suddenly the patient's battery will drain and will become symptomatic, will start having slow channel syndromes. So this is a patient where we felt that we should upgrade this patient to conventional pacemaker or ICD. CRT was indicated in this patient. So this is the patient where the unconfirmed diagnosis is there. So post dual chamber pacemaker, again you can see that the ejection fraction is 25%, battery life is, replacement therapy, significant pacing requirement is there. So the patient who have had, only no dependency on pacemaker, but you have given the ICD to prevent sudden cardiac death, but over the period of time, if the patient starts needing a lot of pacing backup, then in those situations, we should update that to a pacemaker where the RV pacing is not happening necessary. In those situations, if the patient is needing pacing backup, then we should upgrade it to CRT pacemaker so that the patient gets the benefit of ICD, prevention of sudden cardiac death, and also patient would, ejection fraction would not go down further. So a lot of patients who are heart failure patients and where you have given the ICD therapy, over the period of time they will be candidate for CRT therapy, and then after a few years they will qualify for further heart failure treatment like heart transplant and LVADs also. Then this is the patient who has had old case of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy which was unobstructed, and over the period of time, his ejection fraction dropped to 20%, dilated, mild mitral regurgitation, restrictive physiology was also there, and this is the angiogram we could see. So this patient needed, additionally what we could do in this patient. So these the data that 2013 ESC guidelines on cardiac pacing and cardiac desynchronization therapy, and again the guidelines for the diagnosis and treatment of acute and chronic heart failure. These are all published in Circulation. So CRT is class 1
sinus rhythm patient who are there, ejection fraction is less than 30-35%, left bundle branch morphology is there. These the situation, even if the patient is symptomatic, on optimal medical therapy, we should give them the CRT. So this is how a biventricular pacemaker would look like. You can see a CRT, this is the right atrial lead, this is the left ventricle with the defibrillator lead, and this is the coronary sinus lead. So coronary sinus lead, that is left ventricular lead, is very, very important in biventricular pacemaker or combo devices, because that will determine the quality of life and the improvement in the symptoms of these patients. Because if you do not put place at the right place, the patient's symptoms are not going to improve. This is a patient where the QRS complex, you can see from here, that has narrowed down significantly. Initially, it was 160 milliseconds, has come down to less than 100 milliseconds. This is again another patient who has an atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular rate, and we had planned for AV nodal ablation followed by PPI, and that was counseled for dependency on pacemaker for life. So the guideline says that atrial ventricular node ablation should be considered to control the heart rate in the patient who are under. So those who get intermittent atrial fibrillation or permanent atrial fibrillation with very fast ventricular rates, there again we should give them the ejection fraction is less than 35%. We should do ablate and pace, where we should do the AV nodal ablation and do a biventricular pacemaker so that the ejection fraction improves in this situation. So again, if you look at the guideline-wise, indication for AV junction ablation is that only indication where the patient is very, very symptomatic, atrial fibrillation, so we call it ablate and pace technology. And then the patient who are needing a biventricular pacemaker or CRT, there we can ablate and ensure that heart rate doesn't go very fast, and we ensure more than 90% of the biventricular pacemaker in the patient. And this is how the AV nodal ablation is done. So sometimes we desire, because when we do the AV nodal ablation for PSVT or fast ventricular rate, we don't want that AV node should be damaged. But this is a situation where the patient has got very symptomatic, very fast heart rate, has got atrial fibrillation, we ablate the AV node and make sure that the heart rate doesn't go very fast. And to control his symptoms, we give him the pacemaker. So this strategy is called ablate and pace. And then this is how, this is a patient who has had a cardiac surgery, double valve replacement, there also you see that we have done this strategy, and the patient is symptomatically much better. So to conclude, friends, ladies and gentlemen, I would say that the pacemaker is very, very common problem in cardiac management of our patients. There are different type of pacemaker, though we club all of them together and say that this is a pacemaker, but pacemaker could be just a pacing device, it could be very advanced pacemaker where it could be defibrillator with pacemaker, and then it could be even more advanced, we call it CRTT or cardiac resynchronization therapy, which could be only pacing or with defibrillator, or it could be leadless technology, or even it could be subcutaneous ICD. As of now, the technology does not support its ICD for pacemakers. So those who need a pacing support, we should not include subcutaneous ICD. And that is why in today's talk, it was a pacer for which patient, which kind of pacing therapy should be given. So I have not included in detail about the subcutaneous ICD. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Yes, so that's a good question that we do. We have now pacemakers, which we call atrial treatment and ventricular treatment algorithm, where overdrive pacing can treat the ventricular tachycardia also, and the atrial flutter and the atrial tachycardia as well. So those patients who do not have pacemaker, we insert the temporary pacemaker and do an overdrive pacing to control their ventricular tachycardia, which is happening too frequently. And now all these pacemakers, including the same dose one, they have got atrial therapy algorithm, whereby you can treat the, and then AF suppression algorithm, where it does that all AF will be triggered by atrial electronics. So the moment it senses that there are two more atrial electronics, it will start pacing 10% faster rate than the basic rate. And so that it suppresses the sequence of going into atrial fibrillation. So I think this is a very common methodology to treat atrial and ventricular arrhythmias.
Just for the sake of the audience, basically speaking, whatever the pacemaker that Dr. Viveka was referring to, the various modalities, DVI, VDR, etc. For the routine pacing, CRT is cardiac resynchronization therapy for patients of decreased ejection fraction, and CRT-Ds means CRT with a defibrillator function. And for temporary pacing, how often do you, sir, do you routinely do a pacing for right ventricular MIs, inferior wall MIs, and hyperkalemia if it is forming a sine wave pattern as well?
So whenever we see that the patient needs a pacing backup, pacing device, we, you know, to ensure that the patient is safe till we are waiting, we put a temporary pacemaker, and then we evaluate that if there is an irreversible cause like hyperkalemia, post-MI situation, or patient has got dyscentralemia or ischemia, then we, you know, say that this is a reversible cause, you keep the cause and then remove the temporary pacemaker. But if all the reversible causes are not there, then you give them the permanent pacemaker. So temporary pacemaker is very much in vogue, and it is being done regularly. In fact, just before coming here, we had an inferior MI patient in cardiogenic shock. We did a temporary pacemaker and completed the procedure.
And often in our OPDs, we do get patients with bifascicular blocks with widened QRSs or trifascicular blocks with widened QRSs. What is your protocol of advice to the patient and with respect to the audience that we are having here? That everyone obviously doesn't need a pacemaker, so what is your protocol of follow-up, sir?
We always say that, you know, accidental pickups, unless the bradycardia is symptomatic, we should not say if the patient has history of presyncope or syncope, then we should try. But if we have not documented, we will not be sure, because if you know, it's like insulinoma, so you operate and the patient continues to have symptoms. So in this situation, we make sure that the patient's symptoms are corroborated because of the disease. So in this situation, if the patient has now we have got access to what we call implantable loop recorder, external loop recorder for extended period, we can do those things. But we could even do intravascular and bifascular blocks. We can do a EP study where we look at the ventricular cavernosal cycle length, and also we look at the HV interval and AS interval. So based on the EP study, we can decide whether the patient needs pacemaker or not. So as you rightly said, all bifascicular and trifascicular block patients would not need it. So we must evaluate, and sometimes the patient symptoms would continue, and even if you have given the pacemaker, if it was not related to bradycardia. So we need to be very careful. And unfortunately, there are a lot of patients who end up with the neurologist, and they keep on getting, Keptoin and all those kind of drugs, and then the solution is pacemaker. So it's happening both ways, that there is a lot of patients who need it, they don't get the pacemaker, and a lot of patients who don't need the pacemaker, they would get it. So I think the complete evaluation, as you rightly said, is very, very important.
Lastly, for all of us, how much do these devices cost, approximately?
So that's again a practical question, that if the patient needs device, they need to have cost. So it starts with the basic, now with the government initiative and the industry support, the prices of the devices are going down. So the single chamber pacemaker would cost anything like $60,000. The dual chamber pacemaker can be anything from 1,20,000 to, if it is, we are using MRI compatible, and approximately 2 lakh rupees. Then if we are using CRTs, then it could be anything around 3 to 5 lakh rupees. If we are using the combo devices, then again it could be anything like approximately 7 to 9 lakh rupees. And if we are using leadless pacemaker, then it could be 11 lakh rupees. And if we are using ICDs, then it would be 15 lakh rupees. So I think the most of a patient, especially recently, there has been significant decrement in the single chamber and dual chamber pacemaker in cost, because that is the most common one which is required. So the longevity initially in India and South Asian countries, it was life warranty for all these pacemakers, but now after the cost has come down, the companies have withdrawn the life warranty in most of the models, but still the same thing is providing in life warranty for most of the cases. But those who are higher end products like MRI compatible and all, they have got life warranty, but on average the life would vary anything from 10 years to 15 years. Now we have got advanced longevity pacemaker, so that would last for almost 15 to 18 years.
Thank you. thank you, Dr. Viveka, for a very brilliant discourse on the basics of pacemakers. I open the forum for discussion. Dr. Please.
Thank you, Dr.
Is it possible for a second mic?
At the outside, Dr. Viveka, let me thank you for the dual chamber pacemaker that you used in my patient who had a complete heart block just about 10 days back. So, is Micra for all patients or only for single chamber pacing like for VVIR?
As of now, we
as I said that, you know, as of now the technology supports only single chamber pacemaker, that is why it's not being implanted as much as it should be. But the all patients cannot have Micra, but in a couple of years, I think from now, when we have a dual chamber, in fact, Micra technology is so exciting that even the CRTs can come and it will be dependent on a Bluetooth technology. So this is only Bluetooth enabled technology where you put a small capsule in right ventricle, small capsule in right atrium, small capsule in pulmonary sinus, and they will be interconnected with Bluetooth, and so that it can, you know, function, so the complications of leads will not be there. So we will have to wait for some more time, for maybe a year or two, for dual chamber and triple chamber therapies as far as lead disc technology goes.
So, what would be the indications of a pacemaker? Class 1, 2A, 2B, and 3. 3 is no. Class 1 probably must be performed. 2A, additional study needed. 2B needs to be considered. 3, of course, you said no. So, class 1 indication would be what, sir? Sinus node dysfunction, AV block, chronic bifascular block, after acute MIs, cardiac transplant, basically to prevent tachycardia, anything else?
Yeah, so I think if you look at the worldwide data, the sinus node dysfunction is the commonest indication for permanent pacemaker implantation, but if you look at the Indian data, most of them would not, because that only affects the quality of life, not the mortality. So therefore in India, the complete heart block, which affects the mortality also, is the maximum indication for putting a pacemaker, dual chamber and single chamber also. So the absolute necessity of putting a pacemaker, so I would say the class 1, and then is the not only the six sinus syndrome, but also the high degree AV block. So complete heart block in Indian scenario is the most common indication.
Then
bifascular and trifascular block, we have just discussed, Dr. Sen Gupta had said that all of them would not need. So we need to evaluate them. So even if, so that's an indication that the patient would need to be evaluated. So for bifascular and trifascular block, we need to do a extended ECG like Holter or extended loop recorder or implantable loop recorder. Or we can do an EP study to find out the conduction block and do the EP.
So in your set of patients, what about the fixation of reach?
Yeah, so I think the technology is moving in the direction of active fixation. So when we say that screwing lead, so it's, you know, fixes in a particular place in myocardium, so the chances of displacement is very, very low. And then the other advantage is that it is easier to explant. So suppose somebody has got a lead-related complication, then it can be easily explanted compared to the time leads where the explantation may be a little difficult. So we practice to use most of the time the active lead or screwing lead. Even the leadless pacemaker is an active lead. And we have got now, you know, even the LV lead has, you know, now it is coming in the form of active leads or screwing leads.
Just for everybody, tines used to be like kind of box tines,
yeah,
which used to get into the
trabeculae of the myocardium. So tines are like you, it's anchoring a ship, you put a, you know, anchor that gets
down. So, the last question, sir. So, the CRT, left ventricular ejection fraction, less than 35%, QRS, less than 120 seconds, minus rhythm, with NYHA 3 or 4. Now, the newer indications would be the NYHA2
is
the left ventricular branch
along
with QRS less than 150?
Yeah, so there are class 1 indication now. The
more than 150.
Yeah, it has to be wider the QRS complex, more in LVV configuration, the better the outcomes are. But class 2 indication includes also the right bundle branch morphology and between 120 to 150 milliseconds. So those are the indications. And obviously the patient has to have symptomatic class, more than class 2 or not to come medical care.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, are there any indications for any heart rate cutoff? While say they are routine examining a patient, then the patient has come with bradycardia. Is there any heart rate cutoff that below this heart rate we must give basal?
Yeah, so that's a definition that the patient, if the patient is in normal sinus rhythm, sinus bradycardia can also happen at the rate of, you know, 30-35. So unless, so there are a lot of patients where the pacemaker is indicated in sinus bradycardia also, even if the patient does not have long sinus pauses and patient has got high degree AV block. So it is called, so it is, it's not an absolute value for everybody. It is a symptomatic sinus bradycardia, symptomatic sinus pauses. So there is no, for sinus pause, the data based on various trial is that if the powers are 3 seconds or more than that, even in asymptomatic patient, then you must give them pacemaker. But for sinus bradycardia, it has to be symptomatic sinus bradycardia.
Just a small quote on this. Sir said symptomatic sinus bradycardia, which is the most important thing. 6200 is taken as a normal pulse rate. Boris Becker, when he won Wimbledon, had a pulse rate of 48. And Michael Gross from Germany, when he won the Olympic gold medal in swimming, had a pulse rate of 40. So you do not need to give in a pacemaker to these people.
No, that's why I'm asking. Cut off heart rate
is symptomatic. It has to be symptomatic.
Patients come at 48, 45.
If they are asymptomatic, then we don't have to give them. Yeah.
So, in case of
six
sinus syndrome, which kind of pacer
will you use? So, six sinus syndrome is basically atrial-based disease. So, we should give atrial-based pacemaker. But it has been seen that there is 1% annual attrition rate for the ventricular conduction, AV conduction defect as well. So, we should give them dual-chamber pacemaker, but definitely atrial-based pacemaker. So, that so dual-chamber pacemaker in six sinus syndrome is the idea.
One comment on what you said, with elderly people, we want quality, not quantity. For those who can pay, they want quality, not quantity. So, last question, sir, as you said, QRS was 100. So, are there indications other than 6 and 6 when QRS is less than 120? And you will give it?
No, so basically, 6 sinus syndrome is for only pacemakers, for CRTs. Or CRTDs, we have to, that is the place where, so if the ejection fraction is less than 35%, then only we have to look for the QRS duration, otherwise the standard pacemaker will work.
One thing, sir, has to qualify, often you get an ECG report saying sinus arrhythmia. Mind you, that is absolutely normal and a reflection of an absolutely normal heart, sinus arrhythmia.
Absolute compatibility for CT scan or MRI scan? No, so we have got now MRI compatible pacemakers. So there is not CT. CT you can do in all pacemakers. MRI, it is MRI compatible. So there is a company guideline that this is 3 Tesla MRI compatible, this is 1.5 Tesla compatible. So whatever the company says, you can use. But however, the recent data from US has shown that even the older generation pacemakers, you know, 90% of them can withstand an MRI if it is an emergency. So I think those who are totally dependent on pacemaker, there we should be careful about doing an MRI, otherwise all other pacemaker MRI can be done.
CRT?
Well, now all these, you know, even CRT, CRTDs, everything has come MRI compatible. So all devices now, everything is moving in the direction of MRI compatibility.
Sir, thank you very much. Sir, what are the legal implications putting the pacemakers? Patient required single chamber, given 2 chamber, required second chamber, given CTI, giving of the tachycardia. Patient reached to the port. Doctor advised me only single chamber, given the triple chamber. What do you say?
So you are very right that we need to give the patient the treatment he requires. So if somebody comes with an indication for single chamber pacemaker, so if the patient, that is why we showed the guidelines, if the patient has got permanent atrial fibrillation, there is no advantage of giving dual chamber pacemaker. So you can still do that.
I never needed interval based pacemaker. So that is an indication. So we need to stick to the guidelines. And remember, John F. Kennedy had said that I never trust doctors because their guidelines always keep on changing. So you should never, you know, so the current guidelines, you should never, if you have read 2013 guidelines and apply it today, then you will be sued. So you should be updated with latest guidelines, and that is why the general public says that doctors go to conferences to enjoy. That's not true. They go to get themselves updated.
So basically what you're asking is, if there is malpractice, it has to be legally culpable. If it is not, obviously it is as per the guidelines for doctor services.
Sir, pacemakers. Government of India will be the price of the pacemakers. 90,000 pacemakers, 50,000. Single chamber, double chamber, 2 lakhs would be the amount. And CRTI, 3 to 4 lakhs. And 6 months back it was 5 to 7 lakhs rupees. Now it is 3 to 4 lakhs rupees. Now again, company has given a new advice, that a device that is more like 6 or 9 lakhs rupees. Government is reducing the price. And company is increasing price by changing the names and some alterations. What is the company strategy? Government of India is reducing the price, but company are decreasing the price.
Old one and new bottle. I think that's a, you know, policy of the government and the healthcare givers. Take that the price of the, so we have practiced in even the Western world. So the cost of the therapy has to come down, but not at the cost of inventions and going advancement in the technology. So there should be healthy balance between the cost of the therapy and the, because there are a lot of cost which goes into getting a new technology. You would be surprised to know that absorbed stents, which is now not available, $2 million went into development and you know, research and all those things. Who is going to pay for that? So I think there has to be a definite criteria for all those things, and the newer models are not coming just in changing the name. They are putting new technologies, and you can say that the pacemaker, the first pacemaker which was invented, you had to carry it on a trolley and walk with this. Now you can hardly see, just 2 cc capsule. So that is what the technology advancement can do. You don't, you know, otherwise the technology will stop at this and nobody would advance. The longevity at the time when we got independence was 47 years for Indians. Now it is 73 years. So you can imagine that what technology can do. So we need to have, but we should not take, you know, technology for a ride for the whole population of the nation. So we need to have a very healthy balance of the two things. But that is something which we can discuss for hours together.
What sir is saying is absolutely fine. If you see historically, none of these technologies have been invented or developed in India. We are just following the routine. So whenever a company comes in, I mean, sir is talking about a very high-angle device. Even a drug development takes millions of dollars. That is the reason why we are having MDR TB right now, because we have no new drugs for TB, because the West has stopped developing drugs for TB. And we have been extremely callous about treating TB patients. So when you are talking about a situation, when you are talking about the latest high tech in CRT, CRTD, a company from abroad is coming, it obviously is not going to give you free, just like in an ashram. It's going to take money for it, but there has to be a sense of reasonable balance. But at the same time, you have to see, if you are not going to spend for anything, then the newer technologies will never going to benefit somebody who actually deserves it and is willing to pay for it. The point is that there has to be a balance across all spectra, yes. But at the same time, these things would always come at a cost. If you are looking at any of the higher generation antibiotics also till date, which are the life-saving things in ICUs, none of them have been developed in India. None of them. We are talking about so-called generics, which we know what they are worth for. We are talking about multiple things. You have an acinetobacter infection in the ICU, your life is screwed. Believe me, your life is screwed. The combination of 6 to 7 antibiotics also doesn't kill the damn bug. So what do? You're looking at higher generation antibiotics, and if the foreign companies refuse to give you, then you might as well keep on killing the patient. And you're talking about a situation when even the most basic institutes in, let's not name the states or whatever, still die because of vaccination failure, because Japanese encephalitis, the vaccinations are not given. It's been happening over bloody 25 years.
Sir, it was 32 years in 1947.
Yeah.
Okay, it's on. To sum up, let me thank Dr. Viveka for a very marvelous overview of the basement and the absolutely wonderful education that he has mentioned. I think everybody goes back home a lot more knowledgeable compared to what we were before the start of the session. Thank you so very much, sir. And to be honest, I hand over the mic to Dr.
Thank you, sir.